Hello, my name is Austin Habish, the founder of Think Catholic, and you're listening to the Summa in Ear podcast, where we study St. Thomas Aquinas' Summa Theologiae in a way simple and insightful for anyone to understand. The Summa in Ear podcast is brought to you by Think Catholic. Taking two questions of the Summa a day, we'll seek to summarize St. Thomas's responses, discovering the brilliance of Aquinas and his Catholic faith. This is day 17. So let's get started. We're covering today questions 31 and 32 of the Prima Pars, which is on the unity and plurality of the Trinity and our knowledge of the divine persons. The translation that I always use in these podcasts is the second and revised edition translated by the fathers of the English Dominican province. And so let's get started. Article 1, whether there is Trinity in God. In response, the Athanasian Creed says unity in Trinity and Trinity and unity is to be revered. Aquinas explains, the name Trinity in God signifies the determinate number of persons, and so the plurality of persons in God requires that we should use the word Trinity, because what is indeterminately signified by plurality is signified by Trinity in a determinate manner. So Trinity signifies more specifically and precisely than the word plurality does. It means as close as we can get to what we are trying to say, to what God has revealed about himself detailed in the Athanasian Creed. Lagrange gives an insightful comment on that expression as well. He writes, unity in Trinity signifies that there is one nature in three persons, and Trinity in unity signifies three persons and one nature. That's why the phrase is apt for us to name God with. Article 2. Whether the Son is other than the Father. Here Aquinas says we must beware of two opposing errors which have historically cropped up against the truth of the Trinity and of this question specifically. The first comes from Arius, who, according to Aquinas, placed a Trinity of substances with the Trinity of persons. In layman's terms, this would be to imagine three distinct natures, three entirely different kinds of things, instead of the one triune God. This error loses the oneness. The second error would be Sabellius, who, according to Aquinas, placed unity of person with the unity of essence. In layman's terms, this would be to imagine the persons of the Trinity as not being really distinct from each other. Instead of the one triune God, this error drops the threeness. Aquinas continues, thus, to avoid the error of Arius, we must shun the use of the terms diversity and difference in God, lest we take away the unity of essence. We may, however, use the term distinction on account of the relative opposition, but lest the simplicity and singleness of the divine essence be taken away, the terms separation and division, which belong to the parts of a whole, are to be avoided. And to avoid the heresy of Sabellius, we must shun the term singularity, lest we take away the communicability of the divine essence. Hence, Hilary says, it is sacrilege to assert that the Father and the Son are separate in Godhead. We must avoid the adjective only, lest we take away the number of persons. We confess neither a solitary nor a diverse God. Then Aquinas' response to our present article. This word other means only a distinction of suppositum. See the last episode for the meaning of that word. And hence we can properly say that the Son is other than the Father, because he is another suppositum of the divine nature, as he is another person and another hypostasis. Again, see last episode for what those terms mean. Article 3, whether we can say that God is alone. We can answer this question very briefly. We cannot say God is alone if we mean solitary or not triune, but we can say things like God alone is eternal or God alone is omnipotent. So the answer to this question depends on what we mean by the term alone. If we mean it to say something about the substance of the thing, then no, God is not alone. If we mean it as a conjunction and order between a subject and predicate, like between God and eternity or between God and omnipotence, then yes, we can say God is alone, like God alone is eternal. Article 4, whether we can say that God the Father is alone. In a sentence from Aquinas, he says, this proposition, the Father alone is God, includes two assertions, namely, that the Father is God and that no other besides the Father is God. But this second proposition is false, for the Son is another from the Father, and he is God. Therefore, this is false. The Father alone is God, and the same of like sayings. Which brings us to question 32, our knowledge of the divine persons. Article 1, whether the Trinity of the divine persons can be known by natural reason. Absolutely not, because we know God by natural reason, by reasoning from effects to the cause. But the effects down here lead us only to a certain knowledge of God's existence, and then in a shadowy, analogous way, knowledge of his attributes. And because everything affected is affected by all three persons of the Trinity, no effect would betray the real distinction in God of those persons. As Aquinas says, now, the creative power of God is common to the whole Trinity, and hence it belongs to the unity of the essence and not to the distinction of the persons. Then St. Thomas tells us not to try and prove the Trinity by reason alone. First of all, because it is embarrassing to the faith, which is above reason, illuminated by the divine light of faith. It is something supernatural, so let us not lessen its dignity by supposing it is something natural. Another reason to not try and prove the Trinity by reason alone is that for those we're trying to evangelize, they may think that we came up with the Trinity from reason alone, which is false. And finally, and I will quote Aquinas' words here, we should not try and prove the Trinity by reason alone because we know it by the authority of God, which we need to remember ourselves and be completely transparent about when discussing it with others, he says. Therefore, we must not attempt to prove what is of faith except by authority alone to those who receive the authority, while as regards others, it suffices to prove what faith teaches is not impossible. But there were definitely shadows of this revelation before the incarnation, such as the remark from Aristotle that prayers and sacrifices were commonly done in threes. In the books of Plato, we find the saying, in the beginning of the Word, in the beginning was the Word, not meaning the same as Christians do by the procession of the Word, but not entirely off either. As well as in the Old Testament, Aquinas writes, so Moses, when he had said, in the beginning God created heaven and earth, subjoined, God said, let there be light, to manifest the divine Word, and then said, God saw the light, that it was good, to show proof of the divine love. Article 2, whether there are notions in God. The response is yes, and the treatment of this question is lengthy and complex for those who would like to read the text itself, but is summarized by Lagrange in a single paragraph, along with a nice kind of review of what we've learned so far. He writes, because of the Trinity's simplicity, we designate divine things by abstract terms, and by concrete terms, because of their subsistence. Thus, we speak of God and the deity of wisdom and a wise man of paternity and the Father, but we add that God is his own deity and the Father is his own paternity. Otherwise, we would not be able to reply to the heretics who ask how the three persons are one God and how they are three. In a summary of that summary, we use abstract words to remind us that God is perfectly simple and concrete terms to remind us that the three persons of God are truly distinct and subsistent. The Father is related to the Son as by paternity and filiation, and the Father and the Son are related to the Holy Spirit by active spiration and passive spiration. Article 3, whether there are five notions in God. Aquinas begins by defining what he means by notion, as used in the Trinity. He says, a notion is the proper idea whereby we know a divine person, and we have five of these in regard to the Trinity. The first person of the Trinity who does not proceed from another and begets the Son, this gives us two notions, innascibility, so not born from another in the Latin, this is our technical term for the Father as origin, plus the term relating him to the Son, which is paternity. Then the Son gives us the notion filiation, as related to the Father. Then from the relation of the Father and the Son to the Holy Spirit, we get the notions common spiration and procession. That gives us five notions, innascibility, paternity, filiation, common spiration, and procession. Lagrange gives us the same list, phrased a little differently, which may reflect the theological development of these notions into his day in the 20th century. He gives the list, innascibility, paternity, filiation, common active spiration, and passive spiration. Of these notions, only four are relations, so the above five minus and nashability, and only four are properties of the persons, so the above five minus common spiration, and then three of them are personal notions. And Aquinas' words, these three personal notions, i.e. constituting the persons, that's paternity, filiation, and procession. Common spiration and innashability are called notions of persons, but not personal notions. Article 4, may one lawfully have various contrary opinions of these notions? According to Lagrange, this is written against those Greek Christians that held differing notions on the common spiration of the Father and the Son when they denied the filioque, which literally means "and the Son," such as when Catholics confess the Creed on Sundays, saying the Holy Spirit proceeds from the Father and the Son. Aquinas says in response to this article, so we must decide that anyone may entertain contrary opinions about the notions if he does not mean to uphold anything at variance with faith. If, however, anyone should entertain a false opinion of the notions, knowing or thinking that consequences against the faith would follow, he would lapse into heresy. In other words, if someone's notions of the Trinity are obstinately at obvious odds with the Catholic faith, then that person is in a state of heresy. And we must also be wary of any notions which in themselves are not heresy, but would necessarily result in a heretical position, such as any notion that would lead to a denial of the filioque. Now, this matter was probably very fresh on Aquinas' mind, since the Orthodox split with the Catholic Church would have been just previous to him, and the council convened to lay additional magisterial declarations and precision on the question of the Holy Spirit and the Trinity will come a couple hundred years after him. As Lagrange puts it, with regard to the filioque, we shall learn the doctrine of the Church when we treat, in particular, of the Holy Ghost, as he proceeds from the Father and the Son. This doctrine was defined as early as 381 in the First Council of Constantinople. And this concludes the questions concerning the divine persons in common. We have just covered very briefly these questions. These questions were very brief. Questions 31 and 32 of the Prima Pars, which is the unity and plurality of the Trinity. Question 31 and question 32, our knowledge of the divine persons. Again, my name is Austin Habish with Think Catholic, and I cannot wait to see you tomorrow.